We're going to start off with ourselves. Goran and I are doing a presentation on how to not suck at blogging. It's actually quite easy to suck at it, and we're going to teach you how not to do that.
Hopefully.
And then a short break, and then we're moving on to Hannah's presentation on content ROI.
Cool, so let's just jump right in then. All right. How to not suck at blogging. So as Joel mentioned, it's really easy to have a crappy blog. It seems like when blogs first started coming out, in the early 2000s, I guess, when they started getting more popular, people were all super excited about them, stoked. Then blogs transitioned into this sort of, kind of like, we don't talk about it, only teenagers do this sort of thing. But I guess more recently, in the last half decade or so, businesses have really jumped onto this idea of blogging because it's a proven way to get more conversions, get more leads, get more traffic. So there's basically several important phases to creating a blog post, and the first phase is the research phase, like our cat buddy over here, very curious. This is arguably the most important phase of your blog, because if you mess up this phase, you're going to mess up everything else. So you really have to start by targeting your buyer persona. Basically, you kind of have to pick your poison. You have to decide who you're writing for. I say pick your poison because once you nail down who you're writing for, you're eliminating a whole bunch of other people, and you really have to be comfortable with that. You can't please everyone. For example, if you're writing about legal services, you're not going to please a toy manufacturer or something like that necessarily. And it's really important to pinpoint the reason why you're doing this. Are you looking to get more leads? Are you looking for just more traffic? Do you just want to sound like a badass? It's up to you to decide that, but once you pinpoint that, then you can move on.
Next, you're going to want to select your topic. So basically, usually what Goran and I do is we kind of write down a huge list of topics on like an Excel spreadsheet, and this kind of gets us a good idea of the type of content that we want to write about. Next, we're going to then take some of the ones that we've written down on the list, and we're going to research. We're going to find out, have other people been talking about these topics, and how are they ranking? Are they doing well? Do they have a lot of social shares? If I created a post that's similar to this and even did it better, is mine going to absolutely kill my competition? Next, we use a tool. It's a new tool that actually Ran Fishkin, the big guy at Moz, introduced at MozCon, and it's called keywordtool.io. Before that, we were using UberSuggest, and this one actually kicks UberSuggest's butt. So it's a great tool to use to get a bunch of keywords rolling around. You can also use the Google Keyword Planner, and if you want different trends on certain topics, use Google Trends, and you can also sign up for like a subscription to receive monthly email, well, I think weekly or bi-weekly emails on Google Trends or certain topics. Have a seat to folks.
Hey, man.
Door's locked, man.
Yeah, it's always locked.
It's always locked.
Well, okay. So once you've actually nailed down this part of the process, now you have to actually map your content out. It's useful to create a sort of mind map of how your piece of content is going to look. Now, this doesn't have to be visual. It can just be in your head, or you can just describe it. But you need some guidelines. Otherwise, you're just going to ramble and write random stuff. So once you settle on a look, and you settle on a look, by which I mean maybe are you deciding to use a lot of bullet points? Are you deciding to use subheadings? Are you interested in maybe doing graphics specifically for your post? Once you nail that down, you need to start looking at your sources. Now, you already did some preliminary research with Keyword Planner, Keyword.io, but now it's time to actually figure out where this data is coming from. And it's really important to double check all your sources. Like, we're all guilty of going on Wikipedia and sometimes just writing what's from Wikipedia. Like, let's be honest. But I feel like Wikipedia is a good place to start. You can find out a broad definition about a specific topic. You're not really going to get any hardcore details out of it, but it's a good sort of high-level overview. And once you double-check your sources, then you need to triple-check your sources. Dead serious about this. I know it sounds really redundant, but you can have an amazing post, and if all the data in it is wrong, you look like an idiot.
Which, to be fair, is a lot of stuff that's online by now.
Pardon me?
To be fair, is a lot of the stuff that's online by now.
Yes, absolutely. Everyone has a blog. Everyone's, you know, just putting their thoughts out.
So next is the creation phase. This is where you finally get to take all the research that you've done and put it into action, and hopefully you are doing what you're doing correctly, unlike this dog. So creating a headline. So creating a headline is actually an extremely important part. According to Copyblogger, you're actually supposed to spend as much time on your headline as your entire article. So if it actually takes you like 2 hours to create your article, they think you should spend 2 hours creating a headline. I think that's insane. But if you don't have a great headline, no one's going to be able to find your post, and it's going to be useless. So
let's ask you guys. How many of you have blogged here before or currently blog regularly? Okay, that's great. Let's just go around a little bit, I guess, if somebody wants to pipe up. When do you write your headline? Let's start with you, Matt.
When do I write my headline?
Yeah.
I write first.
You write first?
Yeah.
Okay. Anybody else? Yep.
Last.
Yeah.
I do both. I write it when I start writing posts, and then I go back and look at the ones I've written posts to see whether I can improve it.
Yep.
One thing we actually do at Uberflip that you guys might find helpful is we borrowed from Upworthy, where we do the 25 headline brainstorm. So like once a week we have a marketing meeting, we know what's going to be published the following week. So as a group, we kind of like brainstorm 25 headlines for each piece. So after 25 headlines, some of them are a little bit ridiculous, but you definitely come up with some really good stuff that way.
Cool. Anybody else? Yep.
Usually I start with a headline so I can keep all the content in line with that, and then I go back and make it a more interesting headline.
Change it.
Cool.
Yeah, so everyone's got a different answer.
Just a quick question to build on that. How would you blend, say, the Upworthy model of social sharing versus, say, more of an SEO-friendly headline?
That's the problem, right? You need to have a balance. So you obviously definitely need to consider your SEO efforts, but we're actually going to get to that a little bit later. Is that okay?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Yep, so I don't know if this headline is real or not, but here's an example of what you shouldn't do. Diana, Princess Anna, you're all familiar with her, I'm sure, was still alive hours before she died. That headline literally says a person was alive before they died. What does that accomplish? It doesn't evoke any emotion. It's sure it's technically relevant to Princess Diana, the topic of, but come on, man, seriously? That's all I gotta say about that. So what your headline really needs is, first of all, relevancy. If your blog post is about fuzzy bunnies, then you need to include fuzzy bunnies in your headline somewhere. You also need the ability to evoke specific thoughts or emotions. So if you wanted to write very popular, in the inbound marketing, I guess, industry field, it's very popular to share best practices. So if you're writing the 5 best tips to create a blog post, you can call it the 5 best tips to create a blog post, but that's too practical. It doesn't really make you think. It doesn't make you feel anything. You just read that and go, okay, that's the best blog post. Maybe you want to write something more like, these are the five blogging tips that you know so and so uses, and you drop a name like Rand Fishkin, or like experts follow these 5 blogging tips, and that creates a feeling of, pardon me? Yeah, absolutely. Feeling of authority, and once you go and read that headline, you think, oh, okay, these guys seem to know their stuff. I should check out what they're saying. Finally, SEO considerations for your headline. So what you were asking before, actually, it can get really tricky to write an awesome headline and actually have it rank properly. So you need to have a focus keyword in mind. If you're writing about blogging, obviously you need to talk about blogging in your headline. It's a delicate balance. I don't really have a concrete answer I can give you to that. Maybe we can just talk about that. But you need to figure out what you want to prioritize a little bit, SEO or creative writing. If you're targeting something very specifically, a very specific niche audience, maybe you go the SEO route. If you are writing a blog just for the sake of having fun and having a good time and you don't really care about any metrics, maybe you go a little more creative with it. You can be creative and get your SEO in. It just takes a lot of thinking, which is like how Hannah was saying, they come up with 25 headlines for everything. And this is actually a really useful resource if you guys want to write it down. Copyblogger, Joel, you want to talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, so we've all read Copyblogger. I don't know if you guys have ever read McDavid headlines, but this guy's unbelievable and he knows his stuff, and that's why his blog kicks ass. So definitely check it out.
Just on the topic of SEO, one of the biggest tricks for the blog post is you put your keyword in the URL.
Yep.
So the URL is not whatever the name of the post is. The URL is exactly your keyword. And then in your title, if you can't include your keyword in it, then you're probably doing something wrong with the title.
Yep.
If you can't include a synonym of what your keyword is, then you're probably doing something wrong with the title. Because the keyword is what you're talking about. The keyword is what people actually search for. So say you're talking about Princess Diana dying. If you have, you know, person dies overseas as the title to like try to shock someone or whatever, well, why wouldn't you include Princess Diana in that? You know, there's a lot of people who try to do creative things with their title and it becomes nonsensical and not understandable. So you should almost always have the keyword in there anyway, just maybe not in the same order or using different words with synonyms.
All great points. So content, the actual meat of your post now.
So this is basically where you're supposed to really capture your audience. They've searched for your headline, they like the idea, they've clicked it. Now you really need to capture them in your first couple sentences. You can do something like a stat or a quote or say something outrageous or pose a question, but your first couple sentences, if they're not capturing, they're not gonna wanna read the rest of your post. Something that Goran likes to do is he likes to take his most important thought and put it at the very end of in like the meat of his conclusion, and then his second most important part thought he likes to put in his title so that when they're reading, they're first captured and then they're blown away right at the very end.
Yeah, the way I describe it, well, the way I like to do it, I guess, is so in the introduction, the second most important or best point or outrageous statement goes. So that way, there's a ramp up to the mind-blowing thing at the end, whereas if you start with the mind-blowing thing, you run into the danger of fizzling out. Now, this isn't like a rule that you have to follow or anything, it's just like something to consider. And yeah, so from then on, you move on to creating the actual body of your post. Now, if you make a really awesome headline and a really awesome introduction, expectations are going to be enormous. You don't want to bore the reader to death. I cannot speak. So. One tip that we like to practice between the two of us is to just be concise with your blog posts. Not every blog post needs to be 1,800 words. Some of them do need to be 1,800 words. It's up to you to decide, based on the previous research you've done and based on your buyer persona, how much you actually need to write. Don't write for the sake of writing. If you just put fat and fluff in your post, no one's going to care. They're just going to skim over that, click somewhere else. It's not engaging. So if you feel like you need to write 10,000 words, okay, sure, write 10,000 words, even though that's insane. But if you feel like you can get away with 200 words, that's fine too. So one example is if you're writing an article like my 3 favorite tips for social media engagement, you can get away with, maybe get away is not the right term, but you can do like 400 words, 600 words if your advice is actually really important. If you're doing something like the ultimate guide to a topic or the other, you create the expectation from the reader that you're going to create something mind-blowingly amazing. So it's all about expectation management. And like we said, concision is relative, so it depends on who you're writing for, what you're writing about. Keep that in mind.
Next, so at the very end, you're going to want to conclude it, take all your points, and conclude it.
Yeah, wrap it up.
Yeah, basically summarize them all. So basically the whole point of having blog posts, at least for inbound marketing purposes, is it's basically like the carrot on the stick. It's something that attracts the user and turns them into a subscriber, so they might subscribe to your blog and they might want to read more, but you obviously want to get them into your marketing funnel, so you're going to include a call to action at the very end. So the blog post, it might be a sneak preview of what the actual call to action is going to lead to, but this is basically how you draw the user into your marketing funnel so you can continue to market other blog posts or different pieces of resources, white papers, checklists, at a further date.
Yeah. And we'll get into CTAs a little bit later in the presentation. But right now, so you've created your post, it's time to format it. Formatting, really important, because you can write an amazing blog post and it could be this beautiful piece of art that you created, but if it looks like crap, it's going to get treated like crap. So basically, let's take a look at these two pictures first. What's more appealing, the little blue headline that sticks out or this random string of text? Like, this is just a wall of text. Nobody is going to be interested in reading that. They're going to see that. They're going to be like, oh my god, that's such a big time commitment. Whereas here, you get away with a nice little headline, subheading, pardon me, and you just list some bullet points. Bullet points and subheading is really important, as is spacing things out. Obviously, there's spacing here between lines of copy, but it just doesn't look good. So one thing that I found just from blogging myself is that you can get away with creating massive blog posts if you use a lot of bullet points. So if you're worried that your post is too long or just like maybe doesn't appeal exactly to the target, to the buyer persona you're targeting, just add some bullet points in there. They're really easy to follow when they're short. And when you're actually doing bullet points, please, please, please don't turn paragraphs into bullet points. You need to take this paragraph and drill it down into basically three sentences.
Next, you're going to want to pick an easy typeface to read. Something that's not absolutely ridiculous, something that's very simple, like a Helvetica or an Arial or not a Comic Sans.
Yeah, definitely not Comic Sans.
But something that's easy to read,
yeah.
It's actually a really great idea to highlight them like a different color than the rest of your font. Something that I do is actually like if you squint and you can see specific headlines, that's awesome because then a reader will be able to see it no problem. I believe, Matt, you have another Google Chrome tool that you use.
Yeah, do you remember the name of it?
Yeah, it's called Squint Test.
Yeah, Squint Test. So it'll actually,
thing.
Yeah, it'll actually squint your page to make it look like you're squinting. It'll blur it out.
Also, please add images. It doesn't matter if you're Shakespeare. People want to see images. That's why Pinterest and Instagram are like the two biggest social media platforms because people like images. So spend the time, go out, maybe sign up for a Shutterstock account if you're blogging like crazy. If not, don't steal people's images because it's illegal. there's lots of free websites where you can take images from people.
There's also a new one as well that I've been using. It's called the Dollar Photo Club, where everything is a dollar.
Oh, that's pretty cool.
There's images that I've not seen on other sites.
Really?
So,
that's great. Dollar Photo Club.
Dollar
Photo Club. Check it out.
And search.creativecommons.org.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Another useful site, pixabay.com. They don't have the greatest photos, but sometimes they'll have some pretty sweet icons. And if you need icons, like if you need to slap a YouTube logo into your post or something, but don't want to make the effort of tracking down the YouTube logo, you can go to iconsdb.com. It's another icon resource.
Canva is good too, I think.
Yes.
Yeah.
Canva, yeah, they have a premium and a free version. It actually lets you edit your photos in browser. You don't need Photoshop or anything like that. They have a whole bunch of templates set up, so that's canva.com. So, optimizing your post. Now you've created it, you're formatting it. This is the first step towards actually marketing it to your buyer persona. Troy touched on this a little bit. So we'll just get into the WordPress SEO plugin by Yoast that we actually like to use at Powered by Search. So the CMS we use is WordPress. And this makes it really easy for us and kind of streamlines the optimization experience for the blog post. At the top here of the plugin, it just gives you a preview of what your piece of content actually looks like to Google. So when people search something, that's what they'll see.
So I'm just reading the secret last week.
So the way this works is you have your focus keyword. So we're writing a post about the secret lives of kitty cats. Kitty cats is the keyword we want to rank for. We put that in the focus keywords field, and the plugin scans the post, the URL tags to make sure that we're actually talking about that. So you can see here, or maybe it's a little small, I'm sorry, article heading, page title, page URL, meta description. We include kitty cat in all of these. However, the plugin has noticed we don't mention kitty cat anywhere throughout the post. So it appears that in this post, we were attempting to write about kitty cats, but then failed to mention them completely in the post itself. So that's a huge no-no, and at that point, like Trevor was saying, you should really step back and ask yourself, like, what are you doing? It's a good reminder if you sometimes forget maybe like the meta description or something like that. Over here we got the SEO title, so that's actually the title that shows up over here in Google results. And then below it's the meta description, little description. You can also apply meta description to Facebook and Google Plus, so that you don't necessarily have to like worry about Facebook or Google Plus generating automatic previews of your text. You can tell it exactly what you want it to show.
Yeah, social tab.
Yep, you just would have clicked that social tab and you would just put in the same meta description.
Make sure that your meta description is under 156 characters, otherwise it's just going to show the ..
Yeah.
And you're not going to, it's not going to make any sense,
yeah.
Because they're going to have to keep
it. It'll look incomplete even though it's not.
Exactly. Same as, well, we include the name of our company if our SEO title is short enough. So you don't have to do it, but you can rank for your on companies, so it might be a good idea if your post is, if your headline isn't too long.
Generally, it's an authority thing.
Yeah, absolutely.
So like we usually recommend that our clients have their brand in the title tag on any page, just because people know, like, if you're a brand, it's a lot easier to trust you. Like, if you saw two search articles, one was credit, free credit, no credit, that's it. And the other one was free credit, you know, no credit, whatever, and then Bank of America. Like, you click on the Bank of America, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Just because there's a brand, someone's responsible, like, it makes more sense.
Yeah, so some random nobody.
So other things you need to consider, basically.
Next is what Troy was also talking about, making sure that you have a good URL. So you don't want to have some disgusting URL like this that's not SEO friendly at all. You want to have something that actually follows your headline and makes sense. Alt tags and title tags, when you're adding your pictures and you want to finish your post and you're doing it really fast, super, super easy to forget to add alt tags and title tags. Please do it, because otherwise search engines cannot read your photos. This is the way that they know what you're talking about, and this is how you rank for pictures. So make sure that you always add your alt tags and title tags. And Google authorship. So recently Google changed. You used to be able to have your picture next to your post, and it was awesome. And you got like a bajillion more views than the other people that didn't have authorship. And they changed it because people weren't clicking on their ads. So
it's a controversy.
Yeah. So they now it just shows your name. You can still sign up for Google authorship. It's super easy.
Still recommend it. I mean, having your name associated with the brand with your piece of content can't go wrong.
Yeah.
Unless you put out crap.
Google had to take the phone out of it.
They still show authorship on blogs, just not all the time.
No.
Because they're trying to account for people having authorship on every single page of their site. So like, for example, the homepage of Power by Search has authorship on it, so you see a picture of Dev on it.
Yeah, but not individual posts anymore.
Yeah, mine would all remove.
So you, like, Google's trying to say, well, on your homepage, no one's actually the author of the homepage, that's just a service page, nobody cares. So they tried to put into their algorithm, how can we get rid of that issue? And it's just screwing up blogs, because blogs are actually supposed to show the image.
Yeah, it's a work in progress.
Yeah.
Alright, next we're going to touch a little bit about actual content marketing. Making your post look awesome, read awesome, and be awesome, that's just not enough to get it out there. This can be its own presentation, so really we'll touch on this now, and we'll talk more about the actual content marketing aspect of blogging at InboundCon, which is our big conference on September 18th. We'll let you guys know about that a bit later. So you don't want your post to sit in the corner. One of the most basic things you can do to help get visibility is promote it on social media. I know this sounds like super commonsensical, but a lot of people sort of don't think there's value in it, or just forget, or don't think they have the time for it. But you know, there's like Facebook, Pinterest, Instagram, LinkedIn. There's all these different types of networks that attract different types of users. So it's really beneficial to actually get on social media and just share your content with the world. You never know if someone like Rand Fishkin is going to share your post and get your name out there. One thing to keep in mind is that because these different networks have different demographics, you have to cater your posts to each demographic. So LinkedIn, it's more of a professional network. You wouldn't necessarily post cat memes every single day or something like that. But Pinterest, generally people have like having fun on Pinterest. Instagram caters to a younger audience, so you can get away with, you know, silly hashtags or stupid cat pictures that we love or something like that. Another thing that's really important is links. So throughout your content, you're going to want to, where applicable, where relevant, where it is not spammy, you're going to want to link to other content you've created. This is just going to further establish you as an authority figure. Maybe it'll help push prospects down the sales funnel. You're also going to want to link to other people to help build some relationships. Blogging should be social. It's not just sort of a solitary, stuck in a dark room sort of experience. And the way you can build these relationships is by commenting on other people's posts, talking to them on social media. So if you found a source for your blog post that was awesome, or you heavily used somebody else's thoughts, hey, send them a link. Be like, hey, I wrote about you in my post. Thanks so much for doing all this work. You know, I built on it. I built a little bit upon it. And who knows? Maybe they'll share it. Maybe they won't. But you're just getting your name out there. And finally, we're going to... Joel mentioned this before, but now we're going to talk about CTAs, landing pages, and thank you pages.
Okay, so yeah, the whole point, like I was saying before, of creating a blog post, at least for inbound marketing wise, and that's the reason why Uberflip and Powered by Search creates content all the time, is to get people into our marketing funnel. We want to provide them with a beautiful CTA at the end of our blog post, so that we provide them with some form of information that makes them want to give us their email, and then we can continue to market to them. So, like Goran said, this could literally be a an entire presentation on itself, but...
we'll just go over the basics, basically. So, you want people to click the CTA at the end of a blog post. You want to offer something that's valuable to them. We tend to offer a lot of information at PBS, but if you offer a product, maybe you'll offer like a coupon code, product as in a physical product as opposed to a service-based product. So this is our landing page. Joel, you can talk a little bit about this.
Yeah, so the CTA is going to take to a landing page. It's going to have a picture of what your post is about. It's going to have a title or a quote, something to capture them. It's going to talk about what's in the post. You can show some images of how it looks so it's actually legit. You're not getting this total crap for us giving them, for them giving us their email. You can ask them different questions. So we like to ask what industry, how big their company is, if they need help immediately, their marketing challenge. You can ask them different questions all the time.
How do you find ebook downloads, white papers, and so on converting these days versus 2-3 years ago? Do you find that it's still converting well and working well as a call to action incentive?
Yeah, if you have something that's graphically designed and you actually put the work into it, like it's not easy to do. It's not something that's going to happen overnight, but. I feel like if you create a legit post that is, like, if your post is really awesome, how good is, they're going to be like, wow, this post was unbelievable. This resource has to be 100 times better than the post if they're asking for my email address. It might have been better, like, a few years ago, but I still think it's...
The data still shows for us, at least I can't speak for other companies, but for us, the conversion rates are pretty damn good.
Yeah, we have between, like, a... 30 to 50% conversion rate on all of our resources.
And some are a little bit higher every now and then. But it's a case of if you build it, they won't come. But if you build it well, they might come. And our screen is yellow. I blame you, Joel. Jostled the video cable? Hey, we're good. All right, so back to the landing page. Yeah. You can just hit escape. So, and just paste the thank you page URL in. So once the user actually fills out the landing page for what they were looking for, you actually want, it's already copied, Joe.
Oh.
We got this. So this takes them to a thank you page, and this is the actual page that delivers the goods. So if you were offering some sort of coupon code, some sort of promotion, this is where you deliver it. For us, in this case, it was a white paper about the beginner's guide to inbound marketing. We offer it here, and we don't stop there, because now we want to push them along the sales funnel. So on the right side here, we have a consultation form. You can immediately, if you're super impressed, you can immediately request a consultation. You can scroll down for more information, request another type of consultation. Basically, once you have people hooked, you want to keep them hooked. That's sort of the very, very basics of CTAs, landing pages, thank you pages. What's up?
I was going to say, that offer for a consultation, how do you find that converting immediately afterwards?
It's usually not immediately afterwards. It doesn't hurt to have it.
Absolutely.
I don't think we've found that most people don't immediately convert. It's more of a longer process, but what will end up happening is maybe they'll download 3 or 4 white papers, and on that one they'll convert. So it doesn't hurt to have, as long as you're not being super intrusive, as long as you're not asking ridiculous questions like what is the marketing budget of like Uncle Sally who works down the street or something like that. It's pretty good.
Okay.
It's actually, it's different in your industry too. Like B2C, you probably will be able to convert right away. Like if you're like a copy blogger doing something like this and they offer you like an email marketing course or something for however much money, you might convert. But for us, like our market, last time I checked, we had, it was 12 touches before we convert someone. That's just online touches. So there's probably 3 or 4 phone calls in there too.
Yeah.
It's like social media, like everything. It's surprising.
Yeah.
or if you're giving away like a free sample or something, yeah, it is different for every business, and some you might convert more. But before, we never used to have that, and then we're like, why don't we add our consultation page on our thank you pages? And we have seen quite a few actually consultations requested.
So the last thing we want to briefly talk about is email marketing, sort of CRM and paid ads. Once you capture the information, once somebody expresses interest in what you're offering, you don't want to stop there. The conversion page, the thank you page, is just not enough. So to fill out the landing page, you send them a thank you email. It includes the link. It reminds them that they downloaded it. And now since they've expressed interest, you know, they've ticked off all the boxes, all CASA compliant, of course, you can start messaging them. So what we tend to do at PBS is once they download a particular white paper, so if they downloaded the beginner's guide to inbound marketing, we might send them the sort of intermediate guide to inbound marketing a couple of days later, maybe like a week later. What then happens is sort of up to the user. We react based on the workflows, the triggers we've set up, we react to what they do. So if we send them a message saying, hey, how did you like this white paper? They come back to us, they say, you know, it was the best thing ever. They fill out the short survey. We send them another one. We do the thing where it's like, if you like this one, maybe you'll like this. It's, Amazon does it all the time. You ask a social proof, you say, like, we found that the people that download this white paper that you downloaded also download this other white paper, so maybe check it out. In case of them leaving a bad review, that's okay too. You ask them, how can we improve? Maybe this is more your style. The conversation doesn't have to end. And I know I'm talking in very sort of mechanical, practical terms, but it's very important to have these sort of messages be very human. You wouldn't send an email to someone without addressing their name or something like that. So it's very important to actually template out your workflows and email automation to sound like a conversation, because that's been proven countless times that when you're conversing someone, it's more likely to convert them than when you say, dear value customer, you know, just instead of dear value customer, say dear Joel. Targeted paid ads, really super glossing over that. A lot of people think Facebook ads are useless. It's not necessarily the case. Like we've been saying the whole time, like Troy's also been mentioning, it really depends on your business. A Facebook campaign for Coca-Cola, maybe not necessary. They're super popular. If they put out a promo code on Facebook, it's gonna get like a bajillion shares. But if you're not super popular, you can look into boosting posts on Facebook, promoted tweets, LinkedIn ads. Paid ads sort of, in theory, they go against the whole point of inbound marketing. Inbound marketing, you're getting people to your cause by being awesome. It's sort of more of a community building aspect. But it doesn't hurt to sometimes invest a little money and see how it goes. Maybe build a framework for your community, or maybe just support it. But you should not sort of, if your goal is to achieve a high ROI or something purely by inbound marketing, then you shouldn't be looking at paid ads as your number one go-to source. They should be more of a support role. We're actually going to talk way more about marketing your content at InboundCon. It's our big conference on September 18th. Joel will tell you more about it.
Yeah.
The boss.
So we have InboundCon September 18th. It's going to be really, really awesome. Ourselves and Uberflip is also there. We also have companies such as Bing, Shopify, HBC, Virgin Mobile. There's a lot of really awesome speakers this year, and it's right downtown. It's going to be a really awesome event. So make sure to check out InboundCon.com and
to find us talking more about that there. It'll be super interactive. We actually only have two keynotes, which is great, because the panels and the workshops that we have planned, it's going to be much more of sort of the audience interacting with these big name brands as opposed to just listening to somebody speak for 2 hours at a time.
Yeah.
So I think that about wraps it up for us today. Thank you guys for showing up. Thank you for listening. If you want to connect with us, our information's right there. Now, before we take a quick break, let's just take some questions. Anybody have any questions about creating an awesome blog post? Yep.
I was wondering, do people still, just generally, like in the room, do people still use their blog posts to be sent out as email content? Like, I work in a B2B environment, and we tend to send more white papers to our host list now. I'm just wondering if people, maybe different parts of the sales funnel, actually send out. It seemed to be more popular a couple of years ago to be pushing out your...
Yeah, you don't want to replicate your content too much. It doesn't hurt to maybe at the end of the month send someone, here's the best blog post, sort of recap post, but I don't think, in my experience, I haven't found it to be super effective to just send out every single blog post as an email. Does anybody else have any input on that?
I guess, doesn't it? More opt-in for.
So exactly.
Yeah, usually, well, what HubSpot prefers people to do is if they are subscribing to your blog, they can either click to receive daily, weekly, or monthly posts. And this is awesome because it makes your unsubscribe rate much lower because they're actually selecting how often they want to receive your post as opposed to you just automatically being like, we're going to send you daily posts every single day so that you have an insane unsubscribe rate.
Personally, I've seen a resurgence in essentially like weekly newsletters where it's an aggregate of top content that's been posted on the blog or curated content from different sources. And just getting blasted out once per week in a very simple list format. Moz does it, a lot of does it.
It doesn't hurt as long as you're not spamming it out all the time.
Right,
yeah,
it's
so
all
opt-in
based, right?
Yes.
If you have like an automatic feed created and it makes this, it takes your blog posts automatically, and if you're lazy and it's they're gonna look really ugly and show a short preview with no pictures of your posts, we used to have that in our.
A long time ago,
rates are absolutely horrendous. So now if you actually go out, you spend the time, you get a beautiful template, and you create something that people actually want to open, that looks pretty, has pictures, has a description.
And of course, a killer headline,
yes,
subject line.
Headlines,
yeah.
And you show the top, like if you post every single day and you have the top, most highly shared posts of the month, people are going to love that, and it's going to have a much higher.
Yeah, I was wondering if the partner there at Pop Research has any comments for anyone that would help.
Any advice, man?
Caught you napping.
Yeah, caught me napping. on specifically, I guess, content marketing in general. So for me, the big thing is when we're doing content marketing, and you guys cleared it as well, like, we're doing two things usually when we're doing this. One is, it's really consultative selling. We're usually blogging or writing about something, no matter what your niche is, to prove that you're an expert in what you do. So that's what you want to do, but the main goal at the end of it that a lot of people miss out on is they forget to have like that ongoing CTA. So a lot of people blog, but they don't have some other offer. Even something as simple as making what you just wrote downloadable in a PDF can work. Come up with something that you can get them into your marketing funnel, because it's one thing to have them on your website, it's another thing to actually keep marketing to them to get them to your CRM. So that's sort of something I noticed that a lot of people make a mistake on, no matter what business they're in. They're getting traffic there, but then there's nothing more for them to engage with after reading it.
Any more questions or comments?
Just a note on the email thing. I know a lot of people are saying so-so and everything, but we had one blog post we did, it was the ultimate guide to scrape box, and it actually is the ultimate guide to scrape box.
It's massive, yeah.
Yeah, it's huge. It answers every question you possibly have about this piece of software. And it got something like 6,000 unique visitors, but none of them organically. It got all of those unique visitors because it got snuck into the Moz email list. And so we got, I think there was two blasts that went out on, and we got so many visitors. Our most popular organic post does that in like 4 months or something, 3 months. So yeah, email is really powerful. The thing is though, Moz is, they're set up as a media publication. So they make, it's not they make money off of having tons and tons of views, but they've set themselves up as if they were the New York Times or what have you, where they're the information center of the world. And Powered by Search does the same thing. We have a very large community already online. If you're starting and you have no visitors, I probably wouldn't bother setting this up yet. Wait until you've got the actual traffic to your site, and then you can say, this is now worth it for me to invest.
What if you're not in a sexy niche like marketing, and you can't go all over the place, and you're a small business offering one type of service, three types of services.
Give me an example.
You're a plumber, electrician, a contractor, home reno. What would you blog about?
So basically, do you know anything about plumbing?
Are you there on connected to the internet?
Yeah.
There's tons of stuff that you can do, like even plumbing. It doesn't matter what niche you're in. Usually the really simple how-tos.
Yeah. Informational stuff.
It doesn't have to be like epic, like we all think it needs to be, or sexy. Like you'd be surprised if you can just type in how to change your oil.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And you're going to really see something like 300,000 views on a video on how to change your oil. Well, if I was a mechanic and it's sexy, why not make a how to change your oil for every brand of car that is out there? It's going to get you a lot of brand and a lot of views around your brand and build you a lot of trust. At the end of the day, do people really want to change their oil? Not really. I don't, but I want to know the guy who's doing it knows what he's talking about.
Well, the other thing as well is that things like that, they actually demonstrate to people that they don't really want to do it, so they want to know how to do it, and then when they see what's involved, it's like...
Exactly. That's the nail on the head right there.
Yeah. I really don't want to do it.
Exactly.
What did we do that for? We just did that for creating infographics. So we wrote a blog post on how to create an infographic.
It was through research. That one hasn't been published yet.
Okay, so this hasn't been published yet, but we're going to publish this. But we have a... We currently have a blog post that's
done by Matt over here,
cooking up right now.
And he made an infographic about how to actually do keyword research, just the basics of it, and it turned out into this super successful, massive, super informative infographic. It's been doing great, and basically what it's telling us is like, yo, nobody wants to actually do the keyword research, but now they know how to, when they call us up or send us an email, they know what to look for when we're doing keyword research.
I wasn't talking about that. I was talking about something totally different. So basically, we have a blog post, I don't think that has been posted yet, but it's how to create an infographic with little to no design skills. There's lots of different infographic websites out there and that you can easily build an infographic, but it's probably going to look like total crap compared to an actual graphic designer that knows what they're doing. So basically, when we go through the steps, at the end, we say, if you want us to build you an infographic, because clearly our blog post has described that it's not the easiest thing to do, contact us today and our graphic designers can create you a beautiful blog post because they actually get to see the steps and how much work actually goes into creating an infographic.
I think there was one more question over there.
No, yes, maybe.
What's up?
We have a comment actually.
Sure.
Just in reference to the alt tags and titles on images, apart from just helping with Google indexing and whatnot, it is also important because blind readers.
Exactly. Yes.
And there's a lot of times there's been talk about websites needing to have those or those pages will not be indexed anymore or taken down. And it's sort of an on and off discussion. But you don't want to be on the short end of the stick when it says, hey, yeah, if you don't have alt tags or sites off, and now you got to go back to all your old blog posts and start adding alt tags because you don't want
to lose. Always better to be proactive, right?
Yeah.
So take your time when you're writing your blog post, go through the entire thing, make sure that your host is fully filled out, all your alt tags are added. It's better to spend the time, like 5 minutes, quickly reviewing your blog post as opposed to quickly rushing it, making sure it's up by 9 a.m. so that everyone reads it.
One more question.
It's more of a thought.
Sure.
I find with smaller businesses especially, like if you are stuck for ideas on what you should be writing about, just change your mindset. Stop thinking about it as I need to write a blog and start thinking about it as if I was creating a magazine, if I was creating a website about this topic, what would I do?
Yeah, that's a great point.
On the B2B side, a lot of companies are treating their blogs like that, where they're giving it a completely different sort of brand identity as a publishing entity in order to capture leads.
And always put yourself in your buyer persona's shoes. If you're writing a post for teenagers, make it very simple and easy and hip. If you're writing a post for lawyers, make it really intense because they're smart people and they know their stuff. Like I always love to put myself, if I was this person reading this post, would I understand it? And would I get exactly what I'm talking about at the end? So always, yeah, think about the end user. It's not gonna be you reading the post, it's going to be the thousands of people going to your website to read.
If you could take one more question, I'm just curious about when you're doing your research, say, for competition, if I sell couches, if I should be blogging about couches or blue couches with green trim, how do you evaluate that based on, say, the strength or that competition for those keywords, your existing site, and maybe how powerful your site is kind of acknowledged by Google, but how do you decide how broad or narrow within your company focus you should go with keywords?
Can I jump in on that?
Yeah, sure.
So what you're talking about is the difference between a top of funnel keyword and a bottom funnel keyword, or a bottom of funnel keyword.
And like, I guess we do, like, if I have a chance in heck of ever ranking for that, right? If I look and see that.
Well, the thing too is you want to think about preferred landing pages as well. So if you do sell couches and you do want to rank for blue couches, you don't want it to be your blog. Because if someone shows up in your blog and you're like, blue couches are great, blue couches, blue couches, blue couches, they're like, I wanted to buy a blue couch. And they go away. And they click on the next one, which is a site that sells them blue couches, because it's a purchasing keyword. Right? So when you're doing your keyword research, you also want to segment informational keywords from purchasing keywords. Because then, and those are usually the harder ones to get anyway. So you take your blue couches keyword, you put it as a service page or a product page under a category. And then you take reupholster blue couch, whatever, or how to reupholster a couch or whatever. That would be your blog keyword. So when you're doing your keyword research, you'll see a whole lot of like suggested keywords and that kind of stuff. And just in your mind, think to yourself, do I have this product? Will I ever have this product? Or is it an informational keyword? And that kind of stuff. Am I passionate about this keyword? Do I care? Do my customers care? And so once you've got those segmentations done, then you're a lot better off. But yeah, as far as like ranking organically for a keyword goes, if it says there's going to be 1,000 visitors a month to the page, that keyword you'd better write not just a massive post, but a post that you're willing to put a lot of time into promoting. Because if you just write it, it's never going to get anywhere. If you write it, but you include two experts in the niche, you do an interview, and you promote it with like $250 or $1,000 worth of marketing budget, that thing will be number one, sure.
I always say you could be the next Shakespeare, and your post can be unbelievable, formatted, and the writing style. But if you don't market it, and you don't get it out there, like Troy said, it's going to just sit there. It's going to be useless.
It's like playing a concert, but nobody's listening.
Exactly.
No, that funnel stuff's that really be where you want your core web pages versus blogging pages of the customer. Yeah, that's really interesting.
Sure. Actually, I have a slide share about that if you want.
Yeah, we'll talk under it. It's really interesting. Thank you.
Cool. So I think we'll take a quick 10-minute networking break. Help yourself right outside the door.
I think we had a question earlier about how many people are actually blogging. Can I get that show of hands again? Awesome. Okay, how many people are using a tool like marketing automation, like HubSpot, Marketo, Eloqua? What's the sort of?
we built some stuff, but we're in a horrible, mind-numbing, soul-killing legacy system that we're in the process of doing.
Oh! Don't build your own marketing automation system.
No. It's just bootstrap and duct tape until we get the new one in.
Okay. Awesome. What's the new one?
Actually, I'm not part of that setup.
Okay, that's okay. I was just curious. Awesome. Okay, so some people use marketing automation. How many people here, forgetting marketing automation, how many people here use tools to take a look at the metrics around the blog, like Google Analytics, maybe Kissmetrics, Mixpanel, you guys I know do. Okay, cool. So what I'm going to do today is we're going to talk a little bit about content marketing, echo some of the stuff that the guys mentioned in their great presentation, and we're going to drill down a little bit into content marketing ROI. So why are you creating content, and how do you actually figure out whether or not it's actually impacting your business, which is essentially what we want to make sure we know as we're moving down this path. Now, content marketing has been a major buzzword in the last little while, especially in the last couple of years, I would say. And it's not because it's new, because it's definitely not new. It's been around forever. But it's definitely hot right now. There's a couple of reasons for it. You're welcome, ladies. I don't know, or guys, if any of you are into this. So there's a couple of reasons why it's hot. So number one, you're looking at potentially lowering your cost per acquisition, depending on what your model is. Right, so there's a lot of great stats around this. Kapost and Eloqua collaborated on a report not too long ago that actually showed some really legitimate decreases in cost per acquisition, up to 80% in some cases for some companies. Now, the bigger the company, usually the bigger the impact, but either way, you can definitely see a decrease there. You can also see awesome results in terms of increasing the awareness of your brand, thought leadership. These are things that we all know content marketing does. But as hot as content marketing is, there's also a lot of reasons why it's not.
So I actually used these slides in New York, and everybody knew who he was. It was crazy. Anyway, so a couple of reasons why content marketing is not hot. Has everybody here heard the term content shock?
Yeah.
I think so. Yeah, there's like a lot of buzz going around. I think it was maybe 6 months ago when the first post was there. So content shock is basically there's so much content, everybody's getting overwhelmed. It's going to become less and less effective because there's so much content out there. And yeah, to a degree in some industries, it might be a little bit saturated. So that's definitely something you need to watch out for. Depending on the industry that you're in, it might be hard to cut through the noise, right? But the reality is, content marketing, as popular as it is, a lot of people don't actually have the infrastructure to succeed, and they don't know whether it's not effective. I don't want you blogging unless you have an idea of, hey, is this moving the needle? Even if it's not, at least you know, and you can take steps to actually help your company with your blogging efforts, with your content marketing efforts. So when we're taking a look at content across a broad spectrum, a lot of money is being poured into it, and a lot of marketers don't actually understand whether or not it's converting. So I think it was Content Marketing Institute published a report earlier this year saying that only 42% of marketers actually felt as though their content marketing was effective. Only 42%. So that means the rest of them actually don't think it's working or just don't know whether or not it's working. So how do we understand whether or not our content is resonating with people? So before we actually get to the ROI part, which is a little bit more complicated when it comes to content marketing, let's take a look at some of the basic metrics that we want to start to look at. Generally, what I like to do is I like to kind of think of it in two buckets. You've kind of got your engagement metrics on the one hand, and then you've got your actual growth metrics on the other hand. So engagement metrics really tell you whether or not your content is resonating with people. Do they like what you're writing? Do they care about it? And we'll get into what some of those metrics actually are in a second. When you're looking at your growth metrics, these are the ones that are telling you whether or not your content marketing is impacting your bottom line, right? So are you seeing more revenue, more dollars, depending on what your model is your sales team seeing, a bigger pipeline? Right? So what are those numbers that are actually affecting that bottom line moving forward? So there's a lot of different ways content marketing can impact your bottom line. And again, I'm going to speak sort of broadly here, but that's because it really depends on your model. A SaaS company is going to experience different things than an enterprise play that's targeting really big, heavy hitter companies that's not maybe focused on an online model. So you do have to take this and apply this to your model. But there's a lot of things that content can do for you. So potentially, it can drive direct signups. Now, generally speaking, you're not going to see that off of one piece of content. Generally speaking, what you have to try and do is you have to match your content to the stage in the buyer journey. And I'm kind of, again, speaking in terms that hopefully everybody's familiar with, but the only way I'm really going to get a direct sign up from a piece of content is if probably they've been to my website, to my blog a couple of times, I've got some previous experience with them, I've got a relationship with them, and maybe that's the blog post or the ebook or the video that actually cinches the deal, and I can get that direct sign up off of that. Another way you can do it is potentially increasing the lead quality. So changing the tone of what it is you're speaking about can actually help you attract the right type of people. So this goes back to knowing your audience, which you guys talked about a little bit earlier, right? If you're talking about things that don't really resonate with your audience, then you're probably attracting the wrong people, which is why your sales team might be really pissed off at you, right? But if you're starting to talk about well-researched topics where you understand exactly what's going to resonate with your audience, you have the potential for increasing the quality of every lead that goes through your door to your pipeline or even to your e-commerce site. You're gonna have higher conversion rates, again, depending on your model. Increase in lead quantity. So again, that's something that a lot of companies have experienced as they've started to ramp up their content marketing effort. And a shorter sales cycle is potentially something that you can experience as well. So depending on your model, if you do have a sales team that you're working with in collaboration with the marketing team, content has the ability to help expedite that sales cycle. I know for us, we actually work with our sales team pretty closely, and they actually feed us a lot of content ideas. So one thing we do with our sales team and we do with our customer success team as well is we'll actually go to them and we'll say, okay, what's the top non-product related question you're getting? Because our sales team gets all sorts of questions from potential customers. But now we know from the actual customer's mouth what they want to read about, what they want to hear about, right? Not product related stuff, but you know, really basic stuff. And I was actually really shocked to hear that a lot of people really just wanted the basics on how to promote their content, right? And to us, we would think, oh, there's a ton of articles out there on that. But the reality is a lot of people still really need that content. They need those tips, they need that guidance as they go through the process. So talk to your sales team so that you can help them create that content that's gonna help them shorten that sales cycle. Lower cost per lead, we already talked about that a little bit, definite perk of content marketing, and of course reducing churn or keeping customer retention high depending on how you wanna look at it. So a lot of the times what we do is we take content marketing and we think of it purely in terms of new user acquisition, right? So I know I've talked to a couple of people today, they want to start blogging because they want to get new customers. That's great. What about your existing customers? So try and work in some customer marketing in there as well. It's going to help lower your churn rates, keep your retention rate high, potentially, you know, repeat purchases depending on your model. But it's important to really keep that in mind as well. The other thing that you want to keep in mind when you're creating sort of that content for customers is that it's also a really great way to reassure people post-purchase. So depending on what it is that they're buying from you, a really great way to reduce that post-purchase dissonance, especially if it's like a really expensive product that they just purchased from you, is to actually create content reassuring them around the fact that they actually made the right decision and actually helping them take those next steps further. Does that make sense? Any questions? Everyone's nodding, which I think is a good thing, but also feel free to jump in. Cool. So I'm not going to spend a ton of time on this slide because I will also have these on SlideShare, although something wonky happened there with the spacing. Oh well. I will also have these on SlideShare. But when you're taking a look at the two different sort of buckets, whether it's engagement metrics or growth metrics, there's really a couple of key things you want to look at. And you can drill down a little bit further as well. But broad strokes, when you're looking at engagement metrics, you're really looking at things like time on site, pages per visit, how many social shares, what's the bounce rate on my content, and potentially even what's my search ranking, right? Like how many people are actually finding this content and actually are able to engage with it. Now, looking at these metrics through the lens of content marketing versus through something like, I don't know, for example, a sales site is gonna be really different, right? So when you're looking at time on site for your content, time on site on a really long blog post, if it's high, that's great because people are probably reading my blog post. If it's a sales site where I just want them to convert and time on site is really high, it's probably not a great thing because they're probably not finding what it is that they want, right? So make sure that you're looking at these metrics with the appropriate lens. This is focused on your content marketing. When we're taking a look at our growth metrics, this is where you're taking a look at the metrics that are really gonna help you determine whether or not this is impacting your bottom line. So, CTA conversions. Now, in order to understand your CTA conversion rate, you have to have call to actions throughout your content. And I know the guy said it earlier, and I know you mentioned it as well, and I'm gonna reiterate it again at the end of this because nobody does it. People forget to put call to actions all the time. And not just call to actions, but they have to be contextual, they have to make sense, and they have to relate to the person that's reading that piece of content. Visitor to lead conversion. So everybody's comfortable with that metric, they know how to calculate that. How many people visit versus how many people turn in the leads, lead to customer conversion, understanding your cost per lead and your cost per customer, and as well understanding your churn rate. So when you're looking at some of these metrics, they can be a little bit tricky to calculate, but what you can take a look at is, you know, how much time was invested in that piece of content, how much time is invested in your overall content marketing, are you promoting your content? We've had a lot of success using something like promoted tweets for premium content. We're actually doing a lot of lead generation there. So take all of those into account when you're actually taking a look at your cost per lead for your content marketing. So all those metrics are great, but usually you have somebody to answer to. Generally speaking, you're not gonna hand your CEO or your boss all of those metrics and say, here you go. You're gonna take those and you're gonna digest them and you're gonna answer three questions. Does everybody know who this is? Joe?
No.
Oh, no. I know Francois knows who he is. So Joe, this is Joe Polizzi. Yeah. Thank you. He is the founder of the Content Marketing Institute. So chances are, if you go home and you Google content marketing, the first like five posts that you see come up are probably going to be written by Joe. And he's written a lot about content ROI as well. And he put it really succinctly. Really, only three things matter when you're trying to determine. You have to be able to answer these three questions. Is it converting customers?
is it saving you money, and is it helping with customer retention? Generally speaking, that's what your boss, your CEO, and you yourself as a business owner, if you are a business owner, are going to want to know. So calculating ROI is like calculating any ROI for anything else. It's not that complicated. You're going to take the revenue generated and the cost of it and figure out your ROI from there. But the difficulty comes with content marketing is that it's not always that simple, because you have to first define the purpose of your content, which the guys talked about, right? So if all I care about is customers, that's great. And that's probably part of your content marketing strategy. But there's also other indicators of success that you actually want to think about. So this was actually a cool case study from BuzzFeed. And BuzzFeed, if you go on their website, you can actually download the full case study. And what they actually did was they measured the overall impact and what they call the brand lift from people that looked at content, in this case for Virgin Mobile, versus people that didn't look at content. They sent out a really simple survey. And the survey was really around, you know, do you think Virgin Mobile understands you? And here you can see the people that were exposed to the content answered much more favorably than the people that weren't exposed to the content. So you can tell that there's already that awareness that's going up and that brand affinity that's going up. Same thing happened with this question, and this one's a little bit more product related. The people that were exposed to Virgin Mobile's content versus weren't exposed to Virgin Mobile's content actually said that they would think about buying from Virgin Mobile moving forward. So even though there isn't a direct dollar impact here, there's definitely a brand impact here. So that's the other thing you want to keep in mind when you're taking a look at evaluating the success of your content marketing. Does that make sense? Cool. So here's how we think it works. And those of you who follow Rand Fishkin have probably seen this before. And if it worked like this, calculating ROI and the success of your content marketing would be so, so incredibly easy. We think that we make content and people click on it and all of a sudden we make money. Unfortunately, it's not usually what happens. What usually happens is you make content, somebody clicks on it, maybe they like it, maybe they remember it, maybe they see more content, maybe they start to trust you a little bit and give you an email address, maybe, right? And then maybe you make money, maybe you don't make money, maybe they recommend your product, maybe they need your product, maybe they don't need your product. So this is really what it looks like. But you know, this is what we all think it looks like. So when you're calculating ROI, you have to keep this in mind as well. All right, so a couple of ways you can get around that is taking a look at your content marketing efforts in aggregate and taking a look at the ROI number there. Trying to drill it down to individual pieces can be a little bit tricky because, you know, like I think it was Troy that said it earlier, it often takes several touch points for somebody to actually convert to a customer. But if you can actually identify those touch points and actually figure out that path, that conversion path, that's potentially something that you can start to guide people down. Does that make sense? Cool. So we talked a little bit about sort of content ROI and what to look for on a broad scale, but how do you actually boost content ROI? So these three things are incredibly important, and I'm not actually going to talk about these three things because you guys already did a great job doing that. So you have to know your audience. That's a given. You have to develop buyer personas around, you know, each of your potential buyer personas. You have to drill down into what keywords are they researching, what interests them, but drill down even deeper than that. So I know at Uberflip, we've actually really gone to the effort of really developing each of our buyer personas. They have names. It's Nikki, Patrick, and Jimmy. We know what they like. We know roughly what age they're at. We know what level they are in the company. We know how complicated their lives are, because we want to be able to create content that actually speaks to the individual person. And we make sure that when we're creating our content, we have some content for Nikki, we have some content for Patrick. We create a little bit of content for Jimmy, but Jimmy doesn't usually read our blogs, so we don't care as much about Jimmy. But Jimmy comes into the equation during the sales process. So really understand your buyer personas. Craft amazing content. I mean, again, like, your content has to not suck, as the guys put it so eloquently. And you know, that comes down to creating those great headlines, but more than that, it also comes down to taking the right angle for your content. So if you're blogging about something, or if you're creating a video about something, and content, by the way, is much more than just blogging. There's so much more you can do than just a blog post. Put some thought into what angle you're taking. If we're writing about, I don't know,
five best ways to, give me an idea, I'm fresh out of ideas right now. Five best ways to, you know, change your oil, for your example. That's great. If everybody's writing about that, then I need a different take on it. I need to spin it a little bit. I need a different angle on it, and my headline needs to reflect that. So really put some time into crafting amazing content. And of course, be consistent. So, you know, I'd rather you blog once a week than try to blog once a day and then miss a month. So make sure that you're consistent in your content marketing efforts. But like I said, these aren't really enough. So here's probably one of the most important things that actually gets overlooked is, what is your content marketing experience? So we talk a lot about user experience in the context of websites, but we don't talk a lot about the content marketing experience in and of itself. Oftentimes that gets ignored. And you know, as much as distribution matters, because if you write a blog post, you don't distribute it, doesn't matter, no one's gonna see it. The actual content experience matters when it comes to actually looking at having it convert to customers or convert to leads. So here's an example. I actually don't remember what the company name is here. We blurred it out because I felt bad for them. But so this was the blog post, and I didn't edit anything. There was no like sidebar. There was nothing. This was the entire thing. So you can see here, there's no distinct call to action. There's no engagement path of any kind. And I mean, we're at Uberflip, we're big believers of having an engagement path. And that might mean a call to action, and that usually does mean a call to action. There's different layers of call to action. They can be, you know, a little bit more aggressive, asking you for a sign up. They can also be a little bit more subtle, where you're looking at maybe just an ebook download, maybe you're not ready for a sign up, or maybe it's even just a subscribe, or maybe it's recommending more content, right? Maybe it's a, hey, check out this webinar that we're having down the road, or check out this article. If you love this one, you're going to love this one too. And maybe that's the article that converts for us. So there's really no engagement path here at all, nowhere to subscribe, no images or videos, you know, no discovery really of any kind for any other type of content. All I can really do here is head up to the solutions or product or company or contact. I'm not ready for that yet. I just like a little bit more content, please. And there's no mobile experience. So when you look at this online, it's horrible, or when you look at this on your phone, it's horrible. Which means if I get there, because I know how I am, I'm gonna bounce right back off. I'm not gonna stick around if you don't go to the effort of making your website mobile friendly. So instead, try something like this. So this is actually one of our customers. This is a company called Talia, out of, I believe, San Francisco. So take a look at what they've done here. I think they've done a really great job. They've got, you know, really simple imagery, and I know the content marketers at Talia, and I know that they don't actually have a design team, that they're always accessible, so they made this themselves. Really simple, still eye-catching, still were able to use something in there. You can use photography, that works really well as too. So they've done the imagery. They blog, the actual copy in and of itself looks cleaner and neater, it's easier to read. They've got recommended article here. So if the person wants to explore more content, they can. They've got a call to action here, so they can actually subscribe to their content hub. And of course, they've got links there so that they can discover more content. So if the person wants to watch videos or, you know, peruse the blog a little bit, they can actually do that. So make sure that you think about the overall experience. How your content looks is almost or just as important as what your content says, especially when it comes to converting people. So the other thing that really matters is targeting, right? So a lot of us expect that, you know, we put up a blog and it's magically gonna bring in all these visitors and all of these people. We talked a little bit earlier about knowing your buyer persona. Then you have to make sure that you're appropriately targeting your buyer persona through all of your distribution channels. And this comes too with, you know, if you already have a database, and I know we have a range of people here with some people just starting off and some people that already have a pretty extensive database. If you already have an extensive database, target the right content to the right segment within your database. This is where audience segmentation becomes really important. Because if you give everything to everyone, your ROI is gonna be shitty because not everyone is gonna convert. Target appropriately. Really important. If you're just starting off, keep those principles in mind. So when you're looking at your distribution channels, again, target appropriately. Know where your customers live and target them with your content. Control. Okay, this is another big one that actually I think really impacts content ROI, but again, we don't really think about it. Marketers should have control over the content experience, not developers. Sorry, if there are there any developers in the room? No? Awesome. Okay. So, and here's what I mean by this. As a marketer, and even if that means maybe learning a little bit of code or maybe using a platform that helps you manage your content experience, doesn't matter. As a marketer, you need to be able to iterate on your content as you start to understand what's working. So if you understand that CTAs placed here work better than CTAs placed here, you need to be able to quickly do that in your content. If you understand that, this ebook is working really well, I want to feature that on the main page of my content hub or my blog, you need to be able to do that quickly without relying on a developer. If you want to start adding more CTAs, more relevant CTAs, you need to be able to do that without contacting a developer. If you want to add a nested form or maybe even like a pop-up or a CTA overlay, you need to be able to do that without contacting a developer. You need to be able to do that day because your market is not going to wait for your dev to do it 3 weeks from now. So I think this is really important. So find a way to regain control over the content experience. CTAs. We talked earlier about CTAs. Everybody's talking about CTAs. CTAs are really, 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 really important. And again, the CTA has to be appropriate to the piece of content. Yeah.
It's just a really basic question, but yeah. I've never heard CTA before.
Oh, call to action. Sorry.
Oh, it is just
call to action.
Okay.
Sorry, I should have mentioned that. No, that's my fault. I should have mentioned it right off the bat. The CTA is call to action.
All right.
So, but they're so important, so don't forget about them. Call to actions can take a lot of different forms. Like I said before, it can be to just another piece of content to download an ebook or a white paper. We consider those almost like micro conversions for us because we've got somebody through the funnel, or at least through the first stage of the funnel. But a call to action can also be subscribing to your blog overall. A call to action can be a lot of different things. And if you think somebody's ready for it, call to action can also be, hey, try our product or buy our product, depending on what it is. But if it's missing, you're never going to get the sale. You're never going to get the email. So it's got to be there. And also, if you can have the flexibility of requiring email addresses and gating some content, that really helps as well with some of those call to actions. And last but not least, this is our marketing ecosystem. So whatever you use facilitate your content marketing should also integrate really well with your marketing automation tools, which also need to work with your overall CRM if you're using something like Salesforce, for example. So put some thought into making sure that everything works together. Your content marketing, and this is what we see a lot actually in marketers that start using Uberflip, is initially their content marketing is very much in a silo. So they maybe have a WordPress site up, maybe they have some Google Analytics, and what happens is the content marketer is here, and then the demand gen person is over here, and they're the ones that actually run Marketo or HubSpot or whatever it is, and they don't actually talk, and there's not really much data flow between the two, and nobody really knows what's going on, so the content marketing person just keeps creating content. And the demand gen person says, you're not creating content that converts, and nobody understands what's happening. So you have to get all of your systems working together. So find a content marketing platform that will work with whatever it is that you're using. And if you're not using anything else, find a content marketing platform that will actually give you the metrics you need. So are my CTAs converting? Is my content resonating with people? What are the social shares? And a lot of this too, you can get very simply from Google Analytics if your Google Analytics is set up properly. But you have to set it up properly, right? So this is probably kind of the biggest piece to think about, but very incredibly important. Any questions, guys? No? This is pretty much it. I think we forgot to put an ending slide, so usually there would be like a little thank you with a happy face there. But this is where we're ending. But that's pretty much it. So if you do have any questions, let me know. Like I said, I'll throw this up on a slide share. It's tough to answer the content ROI question without talking about each of your individual businesses and what your actual funnels are and what the goal of your content is. But these are all things that you kind of need to keep in mind when you're looking at evaluating content ROI and when you're looking at boosting content ROI. Yeah.
Can you talk a little bit about maybe alternative CTAs besides like buying your personal shit? What is some other stuff that would be a good CTA outside of like selling your own services or product?
Yeah, so outside of selling your own services or product, premium content works really, really well for us. So we do a lot of ebooks, and they also convert well for us. I think there was a question about that earlier. I'm not sure. Webinars are great, but again, depends on your model, right? So generally speaking, anything that's content related tends to convert really, really well. But that's provided that the content that you're creating is of interest to the person that's filling out the CTA. The other thing you can kind of use CTAs for are almost gauging interest in certain products. So I've seen some companies and some startups, this is almost how they do customer development before building out a new feature or a new product, where they'll say, you know, is this something that would ever interest you? Let us know. And then it would just be like a, you know, click it, it goes to a simple form, and it's just like, you know, email me when this is ready to go kind of thing. So there's a lot of different ways you can use CTAs.
You use surveys to create your next piece of content.
Basically, yeah. So a lot of sort of unique ways, and I'm sure depending on like the individual business, we could probably drill down and come up with cool ways for each business to use it as well.
Mm-hmm.
But have the point is to have some sort of engagement path, right? Like, you don't want them leaving without making contact in one way or another.
Can you have too many?
You probably can have too many, yeah. I mean, I think you don't want to be overwhelming, and if you look and all you see is CTAs and the content is totally buried, then it's probably a little bit too much. I mean, you do want the content to be the focal point, but there's other ways you can kind of get around that. So one of the things we do is we do like a CTA overlay, which is essentially like a pop-up.
Is it just as an exit pop-up, or does it come up on that line?
So we have the flexibility to time it the way we want, because we use our own platform, shameless plug. Check out Uberflip. But basically the way it works is, so we use it a couple different ways. We use it on our blog to collect subscribers.
Mm-hmm.
So if you go and if you've been reading for a minute or so, it'll actually pop up. And
mm-hmm.
and we picked a minute on purpose. I know like you read a lot of stats and a lot of them will say, oh, if you do a pop up in 5 seconds, you'll get the most emails. I just find that obtrusive. And we want people to actually read the content. Like we want a high quality lead, so we want
to decide on timing instead of placement of where they scroll the page.
Exactly.
Based on exit. Or
exactly.
You do all the above.
Right now we're just doing timing.
So that's a personal choice, or is that based off actual data of what works best for
We are experimenting with it ourselves. Yeah, we're experimenting with ourselves. At some point we'll likely try exit, we'll likely try all of those things. But you know, that's something we use to collect subscribers. But then we also use that same pop-up to actually gate content. So we've pretty much stopped using landing pages entirely, because what happens when you have to go to a landing page is, you know, you have maybe a blog post with a CTA to download the ebook, and you click on that, and you go to the landing page, and you fill out the landing page, and you get to another landing page where it's like, download the ebook, great. And then it opens up again in probably a different tab, and then you're at a PDF, right? Which is what we used to do, and which is what you should do if those are the tools available to you. But what we've started to do is we've actually started to use that overlay to gate content. So actually, let me show you guys.
How do you gate it, for email or for social sharing or?
Let me show you.
You go on to the InboundTO. I was going to actually give that as an example.
Pardon me?
The InboundTO post that you put up.
We put up an InboundTO post?
No, the CTA that you have under the window.
Actually, let's do this. Uberflip. I'm hitting this keyboard. I think I know which one you're talking about, actually. So let's actually try this. I think I've got one here. Yeah.
So we've done this instead of landing pages. So instead of sharing a landing page, what we do is we just share the URL straight to the content.
Mm-hmm.
This gates it, and people fill it out, and they're
and it's
right
all
in the content.
They can see that they can.
They can see it. It's like,
it's
I'm
like
right
teams.
There. Exactly.
Right.
So
right.
We've actually seen better conversion rates with this, and we've had actually a customer see a 250% lift in conversion when
right.
they compared
right.
it to a landing page. But it's not going to work in every scenario, right? Like, you have to kind of. You know, here you're kind of limited, so if the person needs more context in
mm-hmm.
order to actually buy into this, you might need a landing page. But this has actually worked really well for us, and I know Francois is nodding here because he's the guy that actually measures this stuff.
Do you still have this indexable, like for the search engines, that page? Like, would you
the page behind? Yeah.
You would. So that it would still be show up in search.
Here's the great part though, is that you know how like when you do just the landing page, download, thank you page, that PDF is now shareable, right? So like you don't really have control over whether or not somebody shares it. Here, when you share that link with somebody, if it's a new person, they're getting that CTA. So you're not.
Do you have to do this every time you're a new visitor? Like, do you base it on IP address or by? By the email,
it's just based on cookies.
Yeah, it's just cookie based.
So you, usually what happens, you share the thank you page with your friend and it's ungated, so you only get the first lead, you don't get the next one, mm-hmm. but we get all of them with that page.
Yeah.
And you control it based, then so this is one pixel site wide and then you change it on the back end of your dashboard of what pages are doing what offer, like you have a different offer for every
Yeah,
page, right?
So you can manage, yeah, exactly. You can manage the offers, you can manage the CTA. So that's something that works really well for us. So we're, I mean, with, sorry, going back to your original question, can you have too many CTAs? You totally can have too many CTAs, but I think the key is to use them strategically. And mm-hmm. the key also is like, you have to sprinkle them throughout your content. Mm-hmm. You can't just have one static CTA sitting on your blog forever and that's it. Like, they've got to be strategic.
I noticed you have a small subscribe button in the bottom right hand corner too.
Yeah, this doesn't really do much. We're probably going to change it soon.
When you're talking about putting that call to action delayed to pop up out of a minute in,
yeah.
have you found that positively influencing the quality of leads that you're getting? Because I followed the logic completely.
Yeah.
I'm wondering how far along that goes.
We think so. It's hard to tell because this is the first experiment we've run with that format on that particular blog, so I will keep you posted once we try something new. But the theory is that if they stuck around long enough to read it, they're probably our target market. Yeah.
Could you expand on creating content for retention of existing customers?
Yeah.
And how would you feed it to them through email or?
Yeah, for sure. So a great resource for us for creating content for existing customers, actually our customer success team has started to do a lot of this as well. And we feed it to them a lot of different ways. So we do like email, and we find that actually works fairly well for us. And we also do a monthly, kind of like a newsletter, show it to you guys, called Flipped. So we actually have pretty good engagement on that from our customers. So when you take a look at this actually pretty much includes all of our product updates, but then it also has some of those customer marketing components to it as well, which I think keeps them at ease too, right? So we're constantly feeding them information on how to make their marketing better, how to make their hub better, how to make their flipbook better. And I mean, the great part with doing it in this format is that we can also like include videos. So I don't know if there's like an example of one here.
Does that go via email?
So I mean, there's a video here. So we'll do things, for example, like 5-minute guide to eBooks, right? A lot of our customers create a lot of eBooks. So the content that we create that's more product-y is generally more for our customers, but then every now and then that does attract somebody and that does end up converting somebody. But the more you can sort of set your customers up for success, the better, whether you do it through product, whether you do it through content around your product. Other companies that do this really well, Buffer, how many people here use Buffer? Buffer does it really well, especially now with their suggested links, because I don't have time to go find links, but I want to share stuff, so I'm just going to click on the suggested. That's setting me up for success. Thank you, Buffer. HubSpot also does it really well. So like HubSpot requires you to do like consultation at the beginning. So if you're going to pay for HubSpot, you're going to pay for consultation like X amount of hours at the beginning, because they know if you don't get that consultation and if you don't know inbound marketing, you're going to fail using HubSpot. So they want to set you up for success. We try and do the same thing with all of our content. Yeah.
Do you know when you had that overlay for the CTA
form?
Yeah. So I don't use all these tools, so as the end user, sometimes I'll click on a blog that someone posted on Facebook and
right.
this will pop up.
Yeah.
And I can see the blog, like, you know how you guys had blurred?
Yeah.
They will blur it, it will just pop up and you can't click on anywhere.
That's
on
a
the
little
page.
You should be able to click somewhere on the
so
page.
So you can't click on, but if you scroll up and down with your, you know, mouse roller, you could read the blog. But then you're like, I don't want to give my email address to read the
so
blog.
So I pretty much guarantee you most of them, almost all of them have, like, they can't just have it without like an exit button somewhere. But what
somewhere.
They do, yeah, what they do is
the
they hide it.
Yeah.
So,
and
like,
select it and then you're like, oh, this is blued out, so there it is.
Yeah, but that's the thing, is you have to look for it. That's sort of a bit of a sneaky, like.
So do you guys have an exit button on your?
Yeah, there's no thanks right at the bottom.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, we try to make it clear. Was that not clear?
No,
have to make it bigger?
Make it easy.
Yeah. Yeah.
Do you always just ask for email?
No, actually, I should have clicked off of that. So when you actually click on that field, it actually expands up, and there's a whole bunch of other fields.
So you have it.
Yeah.
Oh,
so they just,
true.
It works. But you have to, like, you have to be strategic there and like figure out what it is you want to ask them. So we keep it to four fields max, like sometimes it's even less than that. But also there's, so this actually integrates with marketing automation, right? So we use HubSpot like you guys do. The CTAs actually also incorporate progressive profiling. So that works.
That's all your own software?
Yeah.
Oh.
Which I did not mean for this to turn into a product demo.
No,
no,
it's just cool.
But yeah, but I mean, the reality is, like, we live and breathe our own product. Like, we use it daily, so it's kind of hard not to talk about it when we talk about content marketing in general.
Yeah.
So how does that translate when you're building the look on mobile?
Yeah.
But what do you guys take away when on your mobile version?
What do we take away on our mobile version?
Yeah, what are you stripping away? Like, what does your mobile look like?
Right, so...
As far as CTAs and
yeah.
Getting people in the funnel.
So, they look really good, actually. Hold on. So this is basically what mobile looks like.
That's not true.
So the CTA is still...
Nice. And is this the one where you enter one and then you get the other fields?
After?
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Magic. I wish Yo was here. He would have loved to see that. But that comes back down to, like, it has to be responsive, right? If it's not responsive, you are going to lose people. I think eConsultancy had a great report out about this, where you saw drops in conversion rates and drops in engagement, so lower time on site for people that are coming from mobile, and they hit a non-optimized experience. So you don't need an app, you just need it to be responsive. Cool. Any other questions, guys? Awesome. Thank you, guys.